he's old school. Used to be a drunk dude. Businessman, nah, everybody love that dude. BobbyBuck.com, BobbyBuck.com. Go ahead, I dare you log on. Yep, he's old school. Yep, used to be a drunk dude. Businessman, now everybody love that dude. BobbyBuck.com, BobbyBuck.com. Go ahead, I dare you log on. BobbyBuck.com. Go ahead, log on. Log on. BobbyBuck.com.
All right. Hello, people. This is Bobby Buck from the Bobby Buck Show. And today my guest on Bobby Buck Show would be no other than Jon Jon from the R&B group Troop. And I know I'm very excited to have him on the call today because where I come from back in the day in Arkansas, back in the 90s and everything, where I was doing nothing but playing all the good R&B music because, you know, trying to holler at the ladies. So, you know, so we got to, you know, we had played Troop and all the other ones back in the day. So really, you know, West Coast raised me from back south. I'm happy to be out here and be able to communicate with these people out here. So I'm going to say hello to you, Jon Jon. How are you doing, sir?
I'm doing all right, man. I'm still hanging in there.
No, that's what's up, man. And, yeah, and also I want to give credit to Anaiya J. Roots for setting up this interview. And
it's
my homegirl I met, you know, maybe 5 years ago, and we stayed in contact. And she's real cool. She's a great singer.
Yeah, that's all right. Yeah, she is. Yes, she is.
So I want to get in with you. What people might want to know is, so what's been going on with you and Troop?
Well, the fellas, you know, we're pretty much all over the place as far as, like, you know, entertainment and stuff like that. We're doing shows. There's solo material that's out there from myself, from Steve to Alan. There's a record that's out right now with Alan and Steve right now. They did a remake of Michael Jackson's Lady in My Life. My new single out there, I Want to Fly Away. Steve has an album out there called Swept Away. Alan's new single, It Don't Make Sense. Troop's new single, I Know. So we're just pretty much, you know, we're all over the place now. We're doing concerts and we're, you know, promoting our new material along the way in these concerts that we're doing, you know, as Troop and everything. And, you know, and also doing solo shows as well. So we're just pretty much, you know, doing it all.
Okay. And, you know, like with most groups, a lot of groups have, like, a lot of internal issues within the group and everything. So y'all been doing all right, you know, staying in touch and staying together, you know, to do what y'all do?
Oh, yeah. Oh, absolutely. We've always, you know, everybody goes through their, you know, their internal issues and what have you. But, you know, we've always been able to go ahead to, you know, to overcome our situations and our, you know, the issues that we have. And, you know, realize that, you know, that there is a God, you know, he put us together to be able to do this and, you know, and to be, you know, and to be in front of our fans. And, you know, this is what they love of us still, even still to this day. I mean, we're coming up on 30 years, April 22nd. So it's like, you know, I guess it's something that it was really destined and something that we were really born to do.
Wow, man. 30 years.
Yeah. April 22nd is the release date of Mamacita.
Okay. Oh, all right. No, man, that's what's up. So y'all got anything planned for that date yourselves? Or?
We're just doing, like I said earlier, we're just doing a bunch of concerts. We actually have a concert here February 2nd at the Redondo Beach Performing Arts Center along with Kenny Lattimore, Stokley from Make Edition, and his new artist, Annalé, and AY 2.0. That's Mark Nelson's new group. So we're doing some shows with them. We have a show here and at the Redondo Beach Performing Arts Center, February the 2nd. Show starts at 8, doors open up at 7. So for those who are listening, you guys get there early. It's going to be an incredible show. We're going to do our thing. We're also going to go ahead and promote our new single as well, I know. So we have that coming along. Then February 16th, we'll be in Atlanta, Georgia, at Morehouse College with Ready for the World, High Five, It's Troop, I believe Force and D's. It's going to be a great show there as well, too. I believe February 24th, we'll be in Fort Lauderdale, doing something in Fort Lauderdale in Florida. And okay. Then I believe March 24th, we'll be performing for Lunel, the comedian Lunel, her birthday party. So we're doing that. So, we're back. We're making our way. Of doing what we do. I'm supposed to be having a performance, I believe, in Las Vegas, February 18th and 19th, I believe, for the Fremont Festival. So, we're at it again, man.
I tell you what, I know a lot of people will be happy to know and everything. A lot of stuff I didn't really know, because, with me, I do a lot of listening, but not a lot of researching, because I was like listening to the music and reminiscing. But I just now seen where y'all got started in the 80s, one of the television, televised, putting on the hits, talent contest.
Yeah. Lip sync show. And it was hosted by Alan Fawcett. Farrah Fawcett's brother, he hosted the show. It was called Putting on the Hits. It was Rodney Benford in his group. It was Rodney, it was Reggie, and there were three other members at the time. And they did the television show, Putting on the Hits, and won $1,000. And a producer had called the show and was wanting to know if the guys can really sing because he liked the dancing. His name was Greg Perret. Greg Perret was a producer, and he played with the Jacksons on the Victory Tour. He set us up with a friend of ours, Michael Henderson, from way back in the day. Michael Henderson, he's been around for years.
Right.
So Michael Henderson did a song on us, and Greg Perret, he did a song on us, Love Toy, and I'm Gonna Make It Right for You. We recorded both of the songs. Let's see. At that time, the meeting at that time with Greg Perret, the group members had kind of basically changed to Rodney, Reggie, Steve, myself, and another guy named Shane. So we were in the group at the time. This is before Alan came along. And we tried out for Greg Perret. He got us to an audition to A&M Records. We were still kind of wet behind the ears. So Shane kind of got impatient about that. He stopped coming around. And Steve knew Alan, so Steve got Alan to go ahead to join the group. We got with each other. Greg started going through some family issues, and he turned us over to David Cook and Steve Cohen. So yeah. We auditioned for David Cook and Steve Cohen, Platinum Gold Productions, and they got us to deal with Atlantic Records. Pretty much the rest is history.
Wow, man, no, that's what's going on, DM. Yeah. So looking back, like I say, because I've been out here in LA, I found, a lot of spirituality within myself, and it's kind of unique how things happen. So when things started to happen for y'all, did it feel like, it was surreal, like you was in a movie, or you just felt it was just right at the time?
Well, in the beginning, even before Alan came apart, we were the group. We were actually five of a kind. We were doing New Edition songs, and we were doing talent shows, and we were New Edition. Nobody could tell me that I wasn't Ricky Bell. I was on all the Ricky's parts. I mean, right. we were that kind of group, man. I mean, we loved New Edition, so we were doing New Edition songs. And then when Alan had joined the group, he started singing, like, original songs that he wrote, you know, himself. And we were like, wow, what's that? We never really thought about really having our own material. But when Alan came along and he started writing songs, we were like, wow. So it kind of, like, you know, it inspired Steve, and Steve started writing, and, you know, we started recording other songs like Time Out and High Quality. And, we did a lot of songs, man. A lot of songs that we recorded, you know, they were just demos, and we even stopped because I believe that we only once, you know, once we were Five of a Kind, when we were doing talent shows as New Edition, we were doing songs like we were doing Cool It Now, Kind of Girls We Like. A Little Bit of Love Is All It Takes, Count Me Out, Mr. Telephone Man. We did Delicious. Those are the songs that we were doing in talent shows and stuff like that. And I believe we only did like one talent show with Alan when we had performed A Little Bit of Love Is All It Takes, and we did Count Me Out. And we won. We won. It was at the school called John Muir High School, and we won that talent show over there. So it was kind of big, but Alan just started working on songs, you know, by himself, and it kind of just like it kind of connected to something that was actually changing for us. Because there was even right. people that they used to always ask us, "Will you guys ever record your own material?" And we were like, "We don't even, you know, that was never a thought process of us. Not until Alan had came into the group." So right. Alan came into the group, and he started, you know, doing songs, and you know, Steve started getting inspired, and it just changed. You know, it just changed, and we hooked up with David Cook and Steve Cohen. David hooked us up with one of his producer friends, Zach Harmon. Zach right. Harmon is the one who did the song Young Girl on our first album. So we were doing a whole bunch of demos with Zach. A lot of demos with Zach, like, you know, like Time Out, Persuasion, High Quality, Don't Give Up on Love. We were doing a whole bunch of stuff. And then all of a sudden we started performing those songs like in regular talent shows, and people were like, "Wow, you guys have your own material," and you know, and they was really loving it. So it's kind of funny that when we talked to a friend from like way back in the day, and they mentioned one of the songs that didn't make the album, it's like, wow, like they remember those songs. So yeah. It was kind of like really cool that we started venturing on our own and doing our own songs. It was really cool, man. And it just changed for us, and we kind of started saying to ourselves, wow, we kind of like, we have our own sound now, to where we're recording our own material. So it was kind of cool. You know, we didn't know that it would, you know, come to be what it, you know, what had happened. We just wanted to go ahead and just, we wanted to get out there and just to let people know that we're here.
Right.
You know, we were here, we're here too. You know, we love New Edition, but we're here too.
Right.
And so we had a whole different type of style of choreography, which kind of, you know, made a lot of noise for us. You know, we considered ourselves to be like a New Edition, but a little bit different. You know, we wanted to go ahead and take choreography to a whole nother level. There's certain things, certain choreography moves that you don't see a singing group do. You know,
right.
We want to be that type of singing group to be able to bring, you know, the acrobats and just all kind of stuff that we do, like with Rodney with his flipping. And, I mean,
yeah.
We want to be that type of, like, wow, check these guys out. You know, I think at that time, the only group that somebody in the group in the Force MDs, they were doing some flips, you know, and it was like, wow,
right,
the Force MDs. Because the Force MDs was like a group that was really, really to be reckoned with. I think at the time, they was New Edition's biggest competition because Force MDs, I mean, the way they performed was incredible, you know. So we kind of wanted that type of flavor just to be different, you know. And it was just, you know, it just so happened that, you know, it was okay for us. It was all right.
Yeah, because since I've been out here, I've been talking to, like, a lot of pioneers out here, which I ran into quite a few of them. And a lot of them was telling me they were just doing stuff, just doing things, and it just evolved, and things started happening. They say in the beginning, we didn't know we was beginning to be pioneers. They say we were just mainly bored, wanted to have something to do.
Right.
And, you know, so, right. Okay. So that's why I said, I sit back, you know, for me being here, I'm honored to be here and to be amongst, you know, the people out here that's doing what they're doing, what they've been doing, what they're doing. Because I'm like, I just be back in Arkansas, just listening to y'all all the time. So yeah, it's an honor to be able to communicate and be around y'all. And y'all still doing what y'all doing. It's much respects to y'all. Because I know it's hard work. Because I know people who's trying to get into it, the hard work that they're going through, but they don't understand the hard work it takes to keep doing. So as far as with your music and everything, so do you have like one particular favorite song of yours or Troop, or is it hard to pick?
It actually is hard to pick because we want to be the type of group how, you know, when you hear albums, from your favorite artist. Every song on an album is, like, really, really, really good.
Right.
You know, it wasn't about how it is now. Two or three good songs on an album, and then you just release the first three good songs, and that's all you really have, and that's really basically it. But see, back in our time, when we had artists like Prince and Michael and, you know, groups like the Temptations and the Jacksons,
right,
and New Edition, you know, every song on the albums were good, every song, and you could listen to every song, and you didn't skip. So we wanted to keep that same vibe going. You know, we wanted to keep that same thing going to where every song that's on an album, every song is great. Every song can be a potential single.
Right. And that's the way to be.
So it's kind of hard. I mean, you have your, I think, As far as the favorite songs that I like to perform, I would actually say I miss performing like the song My Heart. The choreography of My Heart was really, really good. We haven't really performed that in a while. So we're trying to work some things out to where we're trying to bring certain songs back into the show.
Okay.
So that we could, you know, give people a high powered pack performance, especially for, you know, becoming of this 30th year anniversary. So we're trying to put some things together, and, you know, we're going to see what we can come up with. So far, so good. The performing of the songs that we do on stage is a lot of fun, you know, being able to get out there and still do those moves to spread my wings and to do, you know, I'm Not Souped, and, you know, to do all of those dance moves. It's still, you know, it's really cool, man. It's really cool.
Okay. So y'all be hurting next morning, or y'all still in shape?
Still in shape. I think everyone's adrenaline is just really on 10, you know.
Yeah.
Especially during a whole week process of getting ready to prepare for the show, or, you know, even just after the show, everybody is just still like, you know, the jitters are still like there, you know.
Right.
It's a lot of times to where when we're on stage and, you know, the last song that we perform on stage, it's all I do is think of you. It's like when we're on stage and we get to the vamp of that song, it's like none of us really want to leave the stage.
As far as like within the entertainment, with yourself, like, what is like the worst thing that's ever happened to you within entertainment? Is it just been, because I know it's some ups and downs, so there's one thing that kind of sticks out.
It's ups and downs, and it's actually the decision on the business moves that we decided to go ahead to take, which, you know, it's pretty much the downfall. It's just, I think that's really what it is. Making the different business moves, you know, to take the group, you know, in a certain direction that we wasn't thinking that we would go. You know what I mean? So
yeah.
I would say those are the biggest downfalls.
Yeah, I talked to a lot of artists, like I said, talking about pioneers. They say that's the main thing with the business part, because I think a lot of people get into it mainly want to have fun and, make the money and have fun, but then the business part is where you kind of get, taken advantage of.
Exactly. And so because of being taken advantage of, sometimes, an artist can go ahead and make a decision, and sometimes it could be the wrong decision, you know what I mean? So I think that's, really the major downfall that we had. It didn't get, we should have followed and did exactly what the record company wanted us to do.
Right.
Instead of, doing what we wanted to do. Because at the end of the day, it's actually the label that's helping make you who you are.
Right, right. So yeah,
it's kind of so it's kind of like when you go against the grain, against the company that you're signed to, then the things can change for the worse for you.
Yeah, because I see a lot, especially from back, with groups that happened back in from the 90s and maybe before the 80s and everything, that contracts is really what tears people up. what Prince was doing, for his passing and everything. The labels are, they say they like to pimp the artists out. And, so what about as far as the best thing that happened with you within the entertainment?
Say it again now.
So what about the best thing, the worst thing? So what's not the best thing that has happened to you or for you within the entertainment?
You said the what? Oh, the best?
The best,
oh,
yes.
Oh, the best, just, man, I guess, being able to be a part of what everybody else was doing, back when we were out. We had people like New Edition, the Jacksons, you had Michael, we had Guy, we had Albie Shore, we had Bobby Brown. I mean, it was really challenging at that time to be able to get a hit, because so many great acts on Billboard, and, we ended up being a number one an artist on Billboard. So, it was really cool to be in great company with all of those people and running into those people and meeting them. I think that, to me, that was the best part of it, being able to, hang out with some of these people, go to certain functions, the parties and everything, what have you, and just to be able to sit in the, and just to be able to be in the same room with those people and conversate with them and talk to them. I remember meeting Michael Jackson. It's one of my biggest moments of me being an entertainer, and him telling me to my face about how incredible that he thought that our group was. It doesn't get any bigger than that when, the kid comes to you and he talks to you and he tells you how wonderful you are. That's incredible. So
I can imagine
that was a really big moment in my life. And then not too long ago, I had a really big moment in my life of being able to pay a tribute to the Jacksons. I was chosen by them to be able to pay tribute to them. So that was, a great moment in my life. This industry, really, to be honest, as long as an artist comes in and they're good at what they good at
right.
who they are, they're good at what they do, and they're humble and they're nice to everybody. A lot of nice things can happen to you and for you, and you can meet a lot of people.
Right, so there's a lot of hype to the fake it till you make it, or is that, or is it a 50-50, kind of do a little bit of both?
I would say just, being an original, being
right.
good at who you are,
right.
being that humble person, being that person that it's easy to talk to, never being conceited and arrogant about, what God has done for you. Because at the end of the day, it was God that did it. It wasn't you. And because God is the one who
He's the giver. He gave us the gifts to do what we do. So at the end of the day, it's not about having an ego. You know, people, they forget that, you know, ego is three letters. It's E-G-O, which means it's always, every word stands for something. E-G-O, that's ego. That means you're edging God out.
Hmm.
You're letting God know. And you're letting God know that it ain't even about him. You're letting God know that it's about you. And it ain't about you, because you were created by him.
Yeah, I dig that all the way. Yeah. And I see that. That's why, because I've been trying, like, you know, with me where I came from, so being out here for 10 years ago when I first got here, and I tell mm-hmm. people, everybody want to brag, I'm a hustler. No, you're blessed with gifts from God. That's why that's how I look at it. And I know, God brought me a long way to be where I am at. And I'm honored to be here speaking on the telephone with you, on the conference call with you. I mean, you know, back in the Arkansas, back in the 90s, I was just running around, running ragged, listening to y'all. So, it's amazing for me to be out here, to be here doing what I'm doing. So, yeah, believe me, I know God brought me a long way. Yeah. Okay, Bosby, one more thing about when y'all appeared on New Jack City soundtrack. So, so nobody forgets about New Jack City. How was that?
Man, that was kind of challenging, man, because we heard and saw a piece of what LeVert had did first.
Okay.
We saw what they did. They took us in this little theater. We were in New York, and they took us in this theater as a studio, and they were showing parts of the movie, and they were showing us about what LeVert had did, and we were like, wow, what are we going to do? Because the impact that they had was just, it was incredible. It was a monster. I mean, Gerald, Mark, and Sean, they killed that, man. We were like, oh, my God, what are we going to do? So it took us a while to be able to come up with what we came up with. It just so happened, it did take a while, but once we started, it started to just work, and because everything was a cappella, and what the producer had did is he mixed the vocals into the music.
Okay.
We didn't actually sing the song. It wasn't a track, and we went to the studio and we sang, and we sang to a track. No, everybody, we went to the studio to do a cappella.
Oh.
And so the producer, Vassal Benford, that's Rodney's cousin, and I think Jay Ellis, they did the track, and they put our vocals somewhere in the track. And that's how it worked.
Wow, okay.
Yeah.
Man, okay. Oof. It was
some serious work, because that's how, that's what they were saying. They said the producer's going to go ahead and do the track around you guys' vocals. So we had to come up with, we came up with the studio right then and there.
Wow, man, okay.
So
y'all can have like on video, you probably weren't a lot of cameras and stuff back that around then, but y'all have any video of it, or?
I wish, man.
I know it.
And like really something to at that time, if we would have had like an assistant to be with us, to be able to film all of that stuff, that would have been really awesome.
You ain't kidding, man. Man, that's, oof. I'm going to make sure people know about that part right there, though, man. Because people just think, right now, so what y'all think about the new technology and all this stuff, right? Are y'all into it, or do you still keep it old school?
It's okay, but I like old school better, because I like being able to be in the studio to be able to feel the music in the song.
Right.
That's what I'm really into more so. I like being there.
Right. No, I feel you on that. So, all right, we'll probably be get ready to wind down a little bit here, but I'll go check with you. So, are all of y'all from here in California, Pasadena? All of y'all?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, and I like Pasadena. Pasadena got a real cool feel to it over there. Yeah, nice vibe over there.
Yeah, it's all right, man. And I really appreciate the monuments that we have out here. Places like, you know, the Civic, you know, the Pasadena Civic Center. I mean, it was the place where Michael Jackson premiered the moonwalk, you know.
Right.
We have that, and then we have the Pasadena Rose Bowl, you know, Colorado Boulevard, where they have a Tournament of Rose Parade that they have on TV every, you know, January 1st. And people been doing it for I don't know how many years, but, you know, they come and they camp out and they spend a night, New Year's Eve, starting at 12 o'clock noon, and they just spend the night all day, all night, onto the streets of Pasadena, California, on Colorado Boulevard. And they in the parade, they watch that parade go by 5 miles on Colorado Boulevard, and it's on KTLA, Channel 5. And they have that every year. And people drive from miles and miles and miles away to just for that.
Yeah, I think I've seen on the news where people came from North Cal to come down here.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And they came down just to work on the floats.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because they say it wouldn't be part of history.
Right, exactly. That's the only thing I wish that we can do. As, you know, as the group, I would love for us to be a part of the Tournament of Roses. That would be cool.
Well, maybe,
be really cool.
But since you put it out there, it might just happen.
Yeah.
Yeah, things will happen. Okay. All right, well, I'm going to get towards the end, so I'm going to say, so is there, like, any things you want to let your fans know? Just let them know that you're still pushing and coming on out in about the 22nd of, let's say, in April?
The 22nd of April, 1988 was the year that our first single, Mamacita, came out. And it aired in Philadelphia at a radio station in Philadelphia. And there were, when the song first came out, when it got to the radio station, there were two well-known hip-hop artists that was at the radio station, and they were being interviewed. So when the DJ had got the record, he was telling the guys that, you know, I just got this new record. You know, these guys, you know, they're West Coast, out of Pasadena, California. The name of the group is called Troop. This is their new single. It's called Mamacita. They're West Coast cast here from Pasadena.
And
when the song played, the two major hip-hop stars that we know of still today told that radio station to pump, you know, to go ahead and pump that song. And, you know, the song went number one. It started out there in Philadelphia, man. And I want to go ahead and I want to thank Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince, Will Smith and Jazzy Jeff.
Oh, okay.
They were the ones, they were at the radio station when the song first came in, and they, you know, they told that station to go ahead and pump it, and there you have
it. Wow. So are you still communicating with them, or you know?
I haven't seen them in a while, man. I'm trying to, you know, get some people to try to find them. I just want to say hey to them. I used to hang out. At you know, at the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air every now and then. And
okay.
Actually, I used to skate. I used to roller skate with Jada Pinkett and MC Light. We used to have these skate parties out in Los Angeles called World on Wheels. They would have, like, these celebrity parties out there. And
okay.
I used to come out there and skate and stuff. And I used to always see Jada and MC Light there. I used to hang out all the time. Cool people.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So, man, I wish I would have been out here with y'all back in the day.
Yeah,
because I tell everybody about the 90s, man. There's something about that era, though.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm glad I was able to be around. You know, one more thing. I can't believe I ain't thinking about this. So what about the name Troop? Was that a joint effort, or how did the name Troop come about?
Well, let me see. We had a lot of names, and the company just wasn't really going with the names that we had. You know, we was having names like, you know, first we started out with Five of a Kind. We had Jazar, which was everybody's initials.
Okay.
We had we had we they started calling us the guys, and we couldn't keep the name the guys because of the group Guy was coming out.
Oh, okay.
We had about 72 hours to come up with Mama, to come up with the name of the group. And Steve was watching the television show F Troop, so we were putting a lot of things in front of it,
Mm-hmm.
And Steve said, "Let's just be Troop." You know, we made up the dance called the Troop, and he was like, "Let's just be Troop," and we just said, "Yeah," it stuck. And we went on our promotional tour after Steve had graduated from high school in 1988. We went on a promotional tour, and we got to New Orleans with our promotional representative from Atlantic Records. His name was Henry Jefferson,
mm-hmm.
and he told us that we need to go ahead and stand for something. So we were sitting down, we was having lunch, and names started flying around from everybody, and how Alan just came up with Total Respect, and Total Respect of other people, and we was like, that's it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Total Respect to other people. That's what's up.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the rest is history with it, huh?
Yeah.
Well, man, yeah. I tell you what, that's real cool. And I tell you what, so what I'm going to go ahead and do, I'm going to put all your information, once I get this up and everything, and let people know, I get more information from you about your future dates. And everything. I know
mm-hmm.
you said it earlier, but let people know that they can start coming to it, come and check y'all out and everything. And with your solo, I think somebody said you did something recently. Somebody sent me a video. I think it was an outside event. It might have been with Crenshaw. I'm not sure.
Are you talking about the Taste of Soul?
Taste of Soul, okay, all right, yeah.
Yeah, Taste of Soul, yeah, the group. We performed for 94.7 The Wave, the Taste of Soul.
Okay, yeah, because I was talking to somebody about having an interview with you and everything, and then they sent me the video to my inbox. I said, oh, okay, that's what's up.
Yeah, I think that was Tracy Walker.
Okay.
Yeah, he shot that film.
Okay. But yeah, well, I tell you what, man, young, I'm so anxious to come out there and come see you at Redondo. So this could be February the 2nd, right?
Yeah, February 2nd.
Okay, all right, okay. Yeah. All right, well, I really do appreciate you giving me this interview, and I let everybody know that Troop is still here.
Oh, yeah.
Okay,
oh, yeah.
All right. All right, well, I appreciate everything.
Man. I appreciate you. Thank you for having me, man.
All right. Yes, sir. And I'll get back with you a little bit later.
All right. You got it.
All right. This is Bobby Buck from the Bobby Buck Show Audio, and we out.
Log on, log on, log on, log on to BobbyBuck.com, BobbyBuck.com. Log on, log on, log on, log on, log on, log on. To BobbyBuck.com, BobbyBuck.com, LobbyBuck.com, LobbyBuck.com, BobbyBuck.com. Log on, log on, log on, log on to BobbyBuck.com, BobbyBuck.com. Log on, log on, log on, log on, log on, log on to BobbyBuck.com, BobbyBuck.com. LobbyBuck, log on, log on, LobbyBuck.com, BobbyBuck.com.